everyone. Welcome to today's Our Community Stories event. This is the 20th in our series from the city of Durham. Today we're featuring the West End. We learned about them a little bit in our first year in 2020, and 1 hour is never enough. So we are so honored to have some additional residents from the West End on today. As always, this event is brought to you by the City of Durham, the Equitable Community Engagement within the Neighborhood Improvement Services Department. You can find more information about us on durhamcommunityengagement.org, and our Facebook page is Durham Community Engagement. This is a time and space dedicated to hearing from community members and stories that may have been lost or hidden or, you know, less well known in Durham's history. And this is a time to really just learn from them all of the things that have made our city a really great place to be, and a reminder of the things that we can still strive for and achieve in the future. So without further ado, I will turn it over to Ms. Carolyn to share about the West End and introduce her other speakers. Thanks.
Thank you, Laura. Good afternoon, family, friends, neighbors, and viewing audience. My name is Carolyn Ruffin Blunt, and I am a West Ender. Thank you, Constance Sorter Walker, for introducing us and inviting us to the program. And thank you, Laura Biediger, for walking us through the format for the program. It is a pleasure to be able to share and an honor about the community that we grew up in, the lively community that we grew up in. And we are sharing treasures of the heart with you today and hope that you will enjoy it. I will get my other panelists to introduce themselves, and then we'll proceed with the program. Deborah.
Okay. My name is Deborah Gibson Holloway. I grew up on the West End, was born in 1954. My first home was on the West End, and I was there until 1974. And I just loved it. I loved growing up on the West End. It was a great place to live and to grow up, and just had such a great time. My family members were Gibsons. My mother was Sarah Gibson, and my grandmother was Nettie Gibson Easterling. So my family on the West End was Gibsons and Easterlings. So if you knew any of them, that's my family from there. Praise God.
I am Anderson Cootsie Count Council. From the West End of Durham, born and bred. I am a former magistrate and practicing attorney in New Orleans, Louisiana, currently, but hoping one day that I'll be back on the West End. And we are enjoying this conversation about our own neighborhood, and hope it will be very informative to those of you who are listening today.
Thank you, panelists. It was a joy to be a part of the West End growing up. It was a lively community full of lots of kids and lots of families. I was born, bred, and grew up there. And the West End lived out the adage of it takes a village, because the West End was a village. It was a caring community of neighbors who looked out for your children and you looked out for their children. If you had something that they didn't have, if they got some extra vegetables or whatever, they would share it with you. So we shared, we cried together, we laughed together, and we shared, and we looked out for each other. There were some leaders in the community that, and most of them were from the church. Mrs. Mac Lester was from Moorhead Avenue Baptist Church. Eva Merritt was from Second Baptist, and they later changed that to First Calvary. She was our youth leader, our choir director, and our camp director, and our Bible school director. So was Ms. Mac Lester, was our Bible school director and our Sunday school teacher. And she was also our choir director. the pastors were at that time, they were W.W. Hart, I think I have the initials right, Reverend C.E. McLester. And I don't remember the first pastor. Reverend Treadwell was over at Emmanuel. That is the pastor that was there when I used to go and visit. And Mother Harden's church was next door to us, to Moorhead Avenue Baptist Church, when we moved down on Moorhead after we separated from Second Baptist. And she was one of our spiritual leaders. So all of these people, though they were in different places, they all worked together in looking out for the West End. And it was just a joy. They taught us stability. They taught us strong spiritual values. They taught us respect for our elders. They taught us about helping out others and looking back and passing on what you learned to the young kids coming behind us. Miss Debbie.
Praise God. As Carolyn said, it did take a village. And at the time that I lived on the West End, we had, everybody was just, it was a true community, is what I wanted to say. It was a true community. A true neighborhood. Now this picture that they're showing here now is a picture of my mother, Sarah Gibson Green. She's the fifth person here on the front, the standing. And she was one of the graduates of DeShazer's Beauty College. This picture was in 1946, April the 8th, 1946. She was a beautician and she worked at Tip Top Beauty Shop in Hayti. Praise God, when she was doing a cosmetology or beautician. Then just to think about some of the other things that were going on in the West End, I lived on the Jackson Street corridor that was between Jackson, Gaddis Street, Carroll Street, and then the other end going back down Kent Street. And it was just, great, like the people, some of the people in the on Jackson Street. And my uncle's son, he lived on Gaddis. And I remember one time my mama had told me I had a toothache. She said, go down to son's house. And people would remember my uncle's son. His name was George Easterling, but everybody called him son on Gaddis Street. And he was a street sweeper downtown Durham. Back then we had street sweepers. And he was the street sweeper downtown Durham by Liberty Market back up in that section up there. But anyhow, she said, go down son's house. My uncle's son and Uncle Pluck, they lived on Gaddis. She said, go down there and tell them to look at your tooth and pull it. And I went down my uncle's son's house. And him and my Uncle Pluck, they pulled my tooth out with a pair of pliers. Praise God. And it was not funny at the time, but I think I had eaten too much of my grandmother's candy that she used to sell, and I eaten too much of it, not gotten a toothache. So she had him pull that tooth with a pair of pliers. Praise God.
You were tough.
Yeah, that was tough. That was rough, tough stuff. Okay, well, this is the picture here of me when I was a little girl. That's me at the clothesline. That's Aunt Ruth, Mama Ruth. Back then, we called everybody either Mama or Miss. So that's Doss Burt. She's Doss Barber. And that's Mama Ruth. And that's me when I was a little girl. And my mother had left me with Miss Ola, Mr. Wash. Mama Ruth lived with Miss Ola. And Mr. Wash, she went downtown to pay bills. She said when I was a baby. And when I got back, she said she came in the house, she saw this baby laying up on the bed. She said, oh, well, where my baby? She said, that's her laying in there on the bed. She had seen me in there. She said, what y'all do? Glue that bow on my baby's hair. She said, my hair was just as clean as the back of her hand. I didn't have any hair. She said, no, Ruth held up the sprig and I tied the bow on it. So that was Mama Ruth, and that's Doris there. And this other picture here, the Lewendike Club, that's my Uncle Elliot in the middle, the shorter man in the middle. That's my Uncle Elliot Gibson. And they did a lot of things for the West End. They had their own little functions, but he used to drive the van for the blind club. My Uncle Elliot used to drive the band for that, but that's Miss Gina Wilder is on this picture. Miss Bill is on this picture. Y'all may know some of the other ones. You can call their names out. Miss Helen is on there, Brenda's mother. But so I was just very thankful. This was a few of those pictures. All right, Judge, you got it?
Well, the points out most favorably to me is the makeup of the West End. You know, the West End was predominantly an African-American community. Now, of course, there were other ethnic groups that were sprinkled throughout the community, but we were predominantly an African-American community comprised of single-family homes and doubles. Occasionally, you may have seen a multifamily building in the neighborhood, you know, like apartment buildings. But basically, we were single family homes and doubles, which meant that we had the family atmosphere rather than the density and conglomeration of people that you find in these multi-family units, you know, such as the projects and things like that. We didn't have projects on the West End. The family atmosphere was nurtured by the closeness of the families. We all went basically to the same churches. We had about three major, I should say, churches, but of course there were other little smaller churches. But all of our families basically went to those churches. So we had a relationship ongoing every day by virtue of us going to the same churches. The kids, we all went to the same school. So we played together, we hung together, we walked the pipes over the creeks, as we called it back then. Some of us fell in the water like Ben Ruffin. But we did those things together. We walked to school together. We walked home from school together. We got into little fights and skirmishes as kids would do together, but nobody messed with our friends. All of the kids, by virtue of being in the same schools, we were all related socially because there was no segregation in terms of socializing with each other. Because of all of us, we did the same things. If you lived on any part of the West End and you were of age, you played on the same baseball team with me and Ben Ruffin. If you lived any part of the West End as a kid, you played with the same girls. Y'all did the same games on the sidewalk. Everybody was like one big family on the West End. And the good part about it is the grown-ups saw all of us as their children.
As their children, that's
right. You know, we all hung together and you respected every grown person. Yes, if you saw a grown person on the street on the West End, brother, if you were a kid, you better respect them. You better speak to them. If you didn't, they're going to report you back to your parents. And they were close enough, we were close enough that someone could come by your house and talk to your parents and tell them that they saw you doing something in the street that you had no business doing.
That's right. That's right. Yeah.
You were apt to get a little licking. Now, the other thing about it, on the West End, and I say this, and I say it with great pride, I have never been poor. Never. And growing up on the West End, I did not know anybody that was poor.
We thought we were rich.
That's right. Rich.
My mother and my mama one time, we were rich because she came in with $10 worth of groceries and it filled up the table.
My father worked at the factory. We're going to get to the discussions of the socioeconomics of the West End. My father worked at American Tobacco Company. He made $77 a week. There's no way in the world we could be poor. With $77 coming in the door, every family that I knew on the West End had at least one breadwinner in the household. Regardless to where you found yourself as a kid, as a youngster growing up, where you found yourself, you weren't going to be hungry. If I was at Captain Ruffin's house, if they ate, I ate.
That's right.
If I was at Randy Watson's house playing ball in the backyard or whatever, when Miss Irene called him in to eat, she called me in to eat. I was never hungry. Always had the love and care of every adult and every other family in our community. That was what the West End was about.
It was about
family. It was about close relationships. And as Dr. Holloway mentioned earlier, it takes a whole village to raise a kid.
Amen.
We had that whole village on the West.
Yes, we did have
a village. Amen. Amen. Praise God.
That's my grandmother, who was a vital part of our family. She was a matriarch. And she moved to Durham from Charlotte, North Carolina, and bought her family, bought my mother and her two brothers. And mother was a teenager then. And that's my little sister, Cheryl. And this was one of my neighbors when I moved over on Rosedale Avenue. And this is the Miss Wilma Covington that lived on the other side of us. So we lived on one side. They lived on the other side. We had four kids and she had five kids in those little houses, but they made it because she stayed home as a stay home at mom, but Mr. Nathaniel, her husband, worked at the factory. So the factory was a stable job for most of the people who had moved there. And that's how the West End started, you know, because they had to build some houses for those people coming from all over to work at the factory. Mm-hmm. And then, so some people owned their homes. Some people were coming from little areas where they had been farmers and had saved up monies, and they bought a piece of land and they built a house. But in most houses, you saw the grandmother or the grandfather, or you saw more than just the primary family. You saw more people in the house. But it was a loving time. One of my friends asked me, well, what did y'all do? Y'all didn't have anything to do. What did you do for enjoyment? I said, girl, we jump rope every day. We play stop. I said, we would put two boards on a bridge, put another board across there, like a cross, and we would jump springboard. I said, we play baseball in the alley. I said, some of the little boys learn how to play cards. I said, we played pickup sticks on the porch. We call them fiddlesticks. We had sticks that we played fiddlesticks. We played marbles. And my brother Fred, the oldest one, started digging up the backyard, making holes to play golf, because all of a sudden he started golfing. And so he had little holes all over the backyard. My mom said, you can't make a golf course out of rubber. And I saw Billy Morris on the other picture just a few minutes ago. I thought about his mom, Miss Christine. I used to go up there in the afternoons after school to help her with little jobs, dust around. And she knew I loved to sing, so we started singing. And she taught me a song called When Irish Eyes Are Smiling. Every time I would go there, she said, let's sing our song. And so Billy came through that one time. He said, are y'all singing that song again? Do y'all know another song? And it was so funny. Miss Christine said, boy, you get out of here. We're having a good time. So you just enjoy all the neighbors. And no matter how many times we walked that street, going up the street to the drugstore to get us a cool ice or some ice cream, you spoke to everybody sitting on the porch. And if you didn't speak to the people that were sitting out on the porch, the neighbors sitting out on the porch, they call your mama and say, that girl didn't speak. I said I spoke to them twice today. So you had to speak to all the people sitting on the porch, and that's how we learn a lot of their names, because you got to call everybody by name. I said, boy, this is getting to be too much. I said, maybe I'll stoop down. I told my friend Ed one time, let's just stoop down and go to the store. Let's don't stand up straight. Nobody will see us.
That was the respect.
Huh?
That was respect.
That was respect, but you had to speak every time, going up and coming back.
Because that's right.
If you come back, it might be somebody on the porch that wasn't on the porch.
Yeah.
You know, especially at the Weaver house, there was people that were coming and going. So if somebody wasn't out there, they said, that little girl passed by and she didn't speak.
Mm-hmm.
So they taught us that.
Yeah, and we still do it today.
Yes.
Those of us who came from the West End.
Yes.
I call every lady whether she's older or younger, in mm-hmm. the courthouse building. I speak to them, good morning, ma'am. How you mm-hmm. doing, ma'am? If they ask me a question, I'll say yes, ma'am, or no, sir. What? Hey, it's in us, and it was instilled in us in the West End.
It's in us. When I finished college, I went to New York because of job possibilities. And our friend had a family up there, and she encouraged us to come. There were plenty of jobs. So we went. She looked at me. The first thing she said, now, when you get there, you don't speak to everybody you pass on the street. She said, you don't speak to everybody that you see, because I know you're going to talk to everybody. I said, why don't you all speak up there? She said, these are Northerners, and they don't speak to you. You get on the subway, you don't look them eyeball to eyeball and say, are you doing okay this morning? That was so funny.
And you know, that was also heavily nurtured at Lyon Park Elementary School.
Yes.
Miss Deborah, what you know about Lyon Park Elementary School?
Oh, we know quite much about Lyon Park. That was our favorite school. I remember all of my teachers from the first grade to mm-hmm. the seventh grade. I went to Lyon Park from the first grade to the seventh grade. Mm-hmm. And I thank God, Miss Grant, Miss Stevenson, Miss Morgan, Miss Falk, Mr. Battle, and Miss Grissom. Now, Mr. Battle and then Miss Edmondson, seventh grade. Mr. Battle, our fifth grade teacher, loved myself some Mr. Battle. I liked all of them, but Mr. Battle, he was special because, you know, it was a store near the school, and he would allow us to go after we did our work, he would allow us to go to the store and get, as long as we could bought him a pickle bag, it was good. You know, it was okay.
Didn't you have to eat through that fence?
No, because see, you know, y'all about 12 to 14 years older than I am currently.
What's that?
With your sister Cheryl. You remember that Cheryl rapping. So we're in the same age. So by this time, they had another street. Did my stuff fall off? I don't see my pictures up. I don't see me on the camera or anything. Did it fall off? But anyhow, so we would be able to go up the street to Miss Wall's store. The store was called Miss Wall's store then over on Moreland. Okay. And then come on back. So Mr. Battle say, as long as we brought him a pickle bag, mm-hmm. you know, and it didn't take long. But yeah, that was that's our favorite school. Praise God, Lyon Park.
Yeah, so, Lyon Park. You couldn't erase Lyon Park. If you say West End, you're gonna say Lyon Park.
Amen. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. One, two, three, four.
We love you, we will not let you fall. We will keep you up to close of school, just to show we learned the lasting golden rule.
I think the Zoom has some delay on it, praise God. Yes, we love you best of all, Lyon Park.
Amen. We used to meet outside of the school, out there in the back. Every class lined up according to the class. And we would say the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. We would pray and then we would sing the school song. And everybody had a line they had to stand in. Now, if you were a school patrol, you were high society, that's what we thought, because we wore the little white belts. And we were there early, so we were already there. And we had duties in the school. We used to have to dust the pictures in the hallways of the famous Black people they had in the hallway. We go mm-hmm. in to see if he needed anything. We go downstairs to see if Miss Bowie, the dietitian, needed anything. And at lunchtime, some of the boys would take the trays from the girls and clean the trays off and put them back in the window for Miss Bowie. So the patrols were a working group when I came along, and mm-hmm. Ms. and Mr. Coward were in control of the patrols. And we got a trip to Washington every year. I think I went twice, and we paraded down Constitution Avenue. And that was a joy of my life. I just thought I was in heaven. That was the prettiest thing to see all those patrols. And we also participated in the area school program downtown, you know, where they had the inspection. Every school had to go down and present themselves, and they did like military stances. You know, you had somebody who was in charge of the patrols, and they would call out an order and you do it. Miss Grissom had a lady in the community to make our skirts. So all the skirts were pleated, would be a certain inch apart. So when you made that turn, your skirt would click back in order. She made us have the same hairdo, so our hair were parted on one side. Our shirts were alike, and we were just in order. That we had one rival, and that was Pearson Town School. Mm-hmm. And Miss Grissom said, "But she don't have those skirts like ours. She don't have those skirts like ours." So we just enjoyed the school, and it was a joy to go there. I didn't like when we walked to school, Cootsie, we had to pass that Mr. McShee's goat and Mr. McGee's horse, because they had them grazing in the walkway that we would go to. Mm-hmm. And the boys that I walked to school used to run off and leave me so they could see me crying, because I didn't want to pass the goat. And they would say, "The goat won't bother you, come on by." Mm-hmm. And the goat looked at me and would say, "Bah."
Well, you know, you had an option. You could go around the pavement, or you could take the shortcut like we did.
Well, that's the way they would take me. I went that way until I learned the way myself. And then I saw there were several ways you could go. But we would go past that. We would go past that little brick, or that little water, that little creek. Pond down there where they fed.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And you remember, Mr. Schooler was the principal.
Yeah, he was.
And then Mr. Frank Burnett. And, mm-hmm. They were very strict disciplinarians too.
They kept
us in line, kept the guys in line, and,
yes.
And wouldn't let you hang in the hallways. You had to be in the classes and stuff. And there wasn't no kids hanging out in groups out in front of the school. Mm-hmm. You either went to school or you went home.
You walked on the right, going down the hall, and you walked on the left coming back.
I think when I came there, Mr. Burnett was the principal when I came. Mm-hmm. And then I think after him, it was either Mr. Bradshaw and then Mr. Gould after them. Yeah, okay. Mr. Burnett, then Mr. Bradshaw, and then Mr. Gould. Or it might have been vice versa, Gould and then Bradshaw, but yeah. Those were the principals then. Mm-hmm. And now this was my church. I went to Emmanuel, mm-hmm. AME, and on Kent Street from the age of 2 years old. And you all remember Mr. Fred Hargrave and his wife, Miss Lula May. They started taking me to church at Emmanuel when I was 2 years old. They would pass by on the way. They lived on Gaddis Street. Mm-hmm. I lived on Jackson, so they would pass by me and my mother's house on the way to church. And they asked my mother if they could bring me with them to church on Sundays, and they did. And so I grew up here in Emmanuel AME, and this is one of the churches that the Fitzgeralds had built. Of course, we knew that. Praise God. So at the time that I was there, we had several pastors because Emmanuel was AME, so they had pastors that would come. They might come stay a year, 2 years, and then they would go out, you know, the bishop go out and send somebody else new in. So several pastors came through, Reverend Horton and Reverend Epps. And the last one there while I was there was Reverend Crutchfield, J.R. Crutchfield. Mm-hmm. And Reverend Crutchfield stayed the longest. He must have been there for like, he was there a long time. He was there while I was a teenager. And then he was the pastor that married me. Of course, we moved from this church here on Kent Street and moved out to Riddle Road. So the church is out on Riddle Road now, Emmanuel AME.
I used to come there a lot with Miss Roberta Dawson. And when I started singing, she would have little programs, 3 o'clock programs sometimes. And she would invite me as the guest singer to come and sing on her program. And then they had an old piano in their living room. So I'd go up there sometime, and she and Lucille and Mitty taught me some notes on the piano, taught me how to play the piano.
Oh, you learned to play the piano. So, Judge Council, you learned to play the violin, didn't you?
No, this my grandfather.
About the violin.
My grandfather, Mr. Charlie Eubanks, who was one of our community leaders and heavily involved in the community. He wanted me to be a musician of some sorts. So he called me in one day out of the side yard where we were playing ball, called me in to speak to me, and I went inside and he told me to shut the door, and I went in his room and he opened up this case, and it was a violin. So he stood up in front of me and placed the violin up against my shoulder and my cheek, and he placed my hand on the violin, and I'm wondering to myself, what is this about? Hey, what's going on? I don't know about this violin, that's for sure. And he sat down in his chair, and then he said, all right, now play. Play? Play what? So I tried a couple of strokes of the strings, and a few minutes later, he said, you ain't gonna do, that won't do. Put the violin down, boy, and go on back out there with your friends. But my grandfather, he was, like I said, he was one of the founders of what is now Russell Memorial Church. They were down on Massey. They were on Massey Avenue. They started down there on Massey Avenue. Mm. And of course, we had to go to church on Wednesday nights, and the kids would have to sit up in the balcony and be quiet, no sniggling and laughing. Mm-hmm. And the men folk and the women would be carrying on Bible study and to down on the main sanctuary. But he also built the first shelter at the bus stop for Black folks on the West End, which was right across the street in front of Moorhead Avenue Baptist Church, my church, and Carol's church, of course. And my grandfather built a shelter with a bench and with a hood over the shelter to hood you from the rain and the elements. And he would come out and sit every day and greet and meet people getting on and off of the bus. You know, of course, you know, back that time, we'd have to sit in the back of the bus, but my grandfather would sit there and he would welcome everybody as you got off the bus and speak to you and encourage you about doing good things in the neighborhood, encourage you to get your education,
encourage
you to do the right things, to mind your mother and your father. And in that day and time, he didn't allow no men to sit on the bench if women were in the presence. And men, we got that. You know, men around our community knew that. Mr. Eubanks built this, and that's his rules. So the men, they always honored that and let the ladies sit down at the bus stop. But he was one of our community leaders there.
Yes, he used to sit on the porch and we walked to school. So we went down that way, down Rock Street. And you had to pass him going because he's out there early in the morning. And you pass him coming back. And he said, well, good morning, little girl. You on your way to school? And he said, now you have a good day and you listen to your teachers and you do everything they tell you to do. Yes, sir. Coming back, he's going to have another conversation with you. Well, did you decide what you want to do in life today when you went to school? And so every time the kids would go past him, he would talk to them and encourage them. Right. And it was such a good thing because he had a conversation with you, see, the other people you just spoke to, but he had a conversation with you when you passed there. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, very good. Yeah. And he was formerly the governor of New York's gardener.
That's where my
mother was born, in New York.
Who was the governor then? You remember?
Rockefeller. Governor Rockefeller.
Okay.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And my mother was born on the compound of the governor's office. Yep. And my grandfather was the gardener. He moved to the West End, and I don't know how I ended up in Moorhead Avenue Baptist instead of Russell Memorial, but
following Ben Ruffin. You and Ben had to be together every day. You and Ben and Randy and Roger.
Never looked back. And we look at this little white church there that at that time, we didn't have the brick church.
Uh-huh.
And Miss Mac Lester was always cracking the whip on us.
Uh-huh.
And you know, we had to vacuum the church. We had to wipe the benches. And, you know, we had to clean up the church. And, of course, the men, the grown men helped sometimes, but, you know, they worked. So mm-hmm. us teenagers.
So they worked you all boys. They had the boys doing a lot of work.
That's right. We did all the work cleaning up the church. And we had that little push. It wasn't electric, but that little push vacuum where I don't know if they called it vacuum machine back then, but we used them to clean the carpet and clean the hardwood in the churches. But it gave you a relationship to your church that went beyond Sunday morning.
Amen.
Well, and remember, during the summers, we had to attend what was that, Bible?
Vacation Bible.
Vacation Bible School, And I used to love to come down to Moorhead for Vacation Bible School. I would attend mine at the manual, but I'd come down to Moorhead because they gave us that great Kool-Aid with the lemon.
Great Kool-Aid and your peanut butter crackers.
I was older. They gave us the coconut cookies and the lemonade with the great Kool-Aid with lemonade. It was good.
Oh, of course. I told you we wasn't poor down there.
And look, I thought Miss Ollie Fair wasn't gonna ever stop staring, and she would just stare. I said, wonder why she stared so much. She would just stare. So I would tell Edda, well, come on, maybe we'll get a bigger cup, but maybe put just a little bit in your cup. I guess they thought we'd look good.
The cups were small. Sometimes you wanted two of them cups.
No, they only
get the same one. House. Y'all remember this was Mr. Eka Watson house right here, remember?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know who it was when y'all were coming along, this was Mr. Eke Watson's house because it was white with green shutters on it.
On the side of the church?
Right, the house, the picture they showing there, Carla.
That's Miss Dane's house.
Oh, he said Miss Dane's house.
The Watsons lived there. Trudy Watson and them. Mm-hmm. But, and this is the cemetery. This is what y'all was telling me about, the cemetery that won't close in, that y'all used to run through and play.
Yeah. Oh, yes. We went through that to get up to on the top of the hill, as we called it, because he could go to get ice cream and stuff up on Kent Street.
Kent Street.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Now, Freddie worked for Mr. Dame. He used to go and cut wood in the back of the house. And this was a Jewish cemetery, so they always buried people on Saturdays, and it was before sundown. So every time Freddie was scary when he was growing up. That was my older brother. And he would be back there cutting his wood and trying to stack it, and here comes a funeral. And he would run inside and hide in one of the houses, and he would peep out. I think they were driving a horse and buggy at the time. They had gone downtown to run some errands. So he was supposed to have his wood all stacked when they got back. He look and see them coming up the driveway. He run from where his hiding place and run out there. He said, oh gosh, I hope the funeral is over. And he said, I tried to stack the wood real good so it looked like I had cut up a lot of the firewood for him. But he was a scary one.
You know, during our era, we produce, and I do believe it's because of the community nurturing, we produced some very outstanding citizens.
Yes, we did.
Went on to do good things in Durham, and nationally, and some even internationally. And it's because of the nurturing that we got from our school and our churches and our neighborhoods and people.
That's right. That's right.
And the likes, one of my heroes, and I don't like to say it because Carol Ann think I'm biased, but Ben Ruffin was my hero. We grew up together, so I'm not just pushing him because he was my best friend, but because of the things that Ben did nationally.
Mm-hmm.
Ben just blossomed, of course, starting in Durham. We went to high school, junior high school, a college, fraternity. We did all of that together. Mm-hmm. And Ben dedicated himself to the plight of the less fortunate, I would say. Mm-hmm. Now, in many instances, many of us would probably say, oh, you talking about Black people, but I'm not just talking about Black people. I'm talking about, as I said, less fortunate people, whites, Indians. I remember Ben talking about the plight of the Native Americans and how they were going to help them with some programs and things. But he expanded his horizon, and Ben was well respected throughout this country. Throughout this country.
Amen. That's true. That's true.
And Billy Marsh, we had an attorney right up the hill there near Carol Ann's house. He ended up being one of the staunch attorneys and legal scholars in Durham, in the state of North Carolina. And he came off the West End, Billy Marsh.
Amen.
But he grew up right there on the West End from, and he was always carried himself in a very dignified manner.
Always.
Very sharp lawyer. And he fought in the civil rights movement, fought for the rights of Black people throughout the state of North Carolina.
Yes, he did.
Yes. Yes.
A lot of people don't know it, Kusi, but Ben almost didn't make it because when he was born, he had strangulation hernia.
Oh. And
at that time, they didn't have smaller instruments and things like they did for the adults. And this one doctor, I remember her name was Dr. Fox, and I think she was new at it. She sat up all night and knitted what they call a little pocket, and she fitted him with it. And that saved his life. You know, she made it strong so it could hold a scrotum sack up. But that saved his life. Miss Alun Dunn, I always talk about her because she was our pride and joy. She would always give you spiritual guidance. She came up and she prayed over him. And she told my mother that Ben was born to be a leader and that the enemy was trying to take him out. And that's why every time the little child get well, something else will happen. We don't ever know what happened that after he had the scrotum sac problem, his jaws, it wasn't the mumps, but his jaws got hard, real hard under here. He couldn't swallow, and they didn't know what that was. Miss Aluna said, that's another attack. She said, now y'all trace this boy. You talk to this boy, Catherine Ruffin, that was my mom. Said, Catherine, the little boy's gonna ask a lot of questions as he goes up. He's gonna be a little inquisitive boy. And as he asks questions, don't think that they're hard and you can't answer him because he's a child. Give him some kind of answer because he's gonna ask you about everything. And that's what he did. And he said what he was gonna do and he did what he was gonna do. He made an appointment with the head of the Ku Klux Klan in Durham, and the man was talking that we were against him. He said, man, what you talking about? You're striving for the same thing I'm striving for. So they became friends, and Ben introduced his secretary, Ann Atwater, to him, and they became the best of friends. And so he was just always wanting to help somebody. As he grew up, he was always trying to help somebody, but he didn't want you to cheat him. He had a little shoe shine box on the front porch where you shine shoes on Saturday.
Do I know?
You remember that shoe shine box?
Yeah, I don't think I got my money from him yet.
Now, speaking of shoe shine, remember the man used to be on the West End, Mr. Sir Melvin, had a shoe shine stand on the West End.
Yeah.
It was up there but near Curl Street. It was on Jackson Street, but it was near Curl. Yeah, he had this little shoe shine stand up there. And then we had, remember Miss Lucy Adams, she was the babysitter on the West End. She kept a lot of the children on the West End for the parents who worked at the factory.
And so did Elsa Dean Bynum.
And my partner, Mama Lucy. But the further thing about going to Mama Lucy's house, she kept a lot of us, but you go to her house, you didn't ever know what you was gonna find. One day we was over there, she had a turtle in the bathtub. He was gonna become stew later, soup or something later. And we look here, so you know, we excited and scared at the same time. One time she had remember the chicken man used to come through, had the chicken on the back of the back car. The chicken man used to drive through. She had a bad chicken sometime and have them going on. And so we were just thankful. Then this Mr. picture of Godwin School of Dance was on the West End. I remember as a little girl, I would go up the me and Faye and Annie, me and Faye Jackson, Anna Burkett, we would go up the stairs and look. We couldn't go in. We couldn't go all the way up in there because we'd be the little white girls in there dancing. Mm-hmm. We would go stand on the stairs and look sometime because we want to. But and then the Fitzgerald house, the big brick Fitzgerald house on on the corner of Jackson and Kent. That mm-hmm. became the Jackson House. And we would sit up there on the porch and sing songs like we were Diana Ross and the Supremes. A Gladys Knight and the Pip. And we would sit up on the corner and sing songs. And stuff. We just had, we used to have a good time. Like you said, like Judge Anderson said, Coulson, we didn't think we were poor. We were not poor. We had a great time. We grew up in a rich, poor neighborhood. It was a poor neighborhood.
And we had many Black owned businesses too.
Yeah. All Black businesses. And the house you're talking about that where you say the lady where the people stayed in the Fitzgerald house, mm-hmm. that house had a girl that stayed there. My sister had a little job around it at the house. That girl became a famous dancer on Broadway in New York, but nothing was in the paper about it, mm-hmm. you know, because mm-hmm. she's a Black girl, but she was very popular. I don't remember her name now. Mm-hmm. And Celestine, you may made friends with her because she was a young girl, almost Celestine's age, but mm-hmm. she became a famous dancer in New York. So the dance did carry over from the corner to the house over there.
Yes, and we just lost Andre Talley.
Yeah.
Yes.
Was mm-hmm. the world-renowned fashion.
Yes.
And for Vogue magazine.
What street did he stay on, Coosie? What street?
Moreland Avenue. Okay. And we have Mayor Elaine O'Neill.
Yeah.
She is the Durham mayor now.
Yeah, we're
very thankful for her.
Strong family.
Yes, yeah. What the Lord is doing with her and that family, like you said, the whole family. The picture that they have up now. See, we call this West End Old School. These were some of my classmates from the West End, some of us from Live Park. There, Frank Reed back there. We went to Live Park together, Marilyn Couch. You remember Ann Couch? This is her daughter on the front.
Yeah, I see Marilyn Ann Couch. She was a smart little girl growing up. She's about 5 years old. You write, you give her a $5 bill, write the grocery list. And she go up there on the corner and come back with Miss K. Francis groceries and didn't get hit. I mean, she was just an old lady. We always call her old lady before time, but she was a smart little girl.
And she still is. This is my son, Derek Holloway. He's an artist from the West End, born on the West End. And this is the Durham Bull here that he did Derek Holloway. That's the Durham Bull. It's a very popular piece. You'll see that all around Durham and from people
over here on this side.
Mm-hmm. On the picture, on the side. Yeah, that's the Durham Bull that he did.
That's
my oldest son, Derek Holloway, a West End artist, born on the West End. Praise God. So the West End has produced a lot of good people. We're just talking about Andre Talley.
Yes.
And let me give you a quick little story about this building right here. This was the Art Roof Rolling Pin Bakery. We got West End on the side of it now. On the front of it has Gibson Girl. And of course, my name is Deborah Gibson. I was Gibson Girl on the West End. So one day I decided I was going to go in and just go in and browse and look around. So I was in there browsing and everything. So it was only myself and the other person that was working in the store because another lady left out. So anyway, so then we started talking. And I saw a couple of things I asked about. We started talking, so I asked her, I told her my name. I said, my name is Deborah. She said, that's nice. She said, my mother's name is Deborah. I said, that's good. We talked a little bit. And then I said, well, what's your name? She said, her name was Sarah. My mother's name was Sarah.
Well, isn't that stuff? Your family aligned right with hers.
That was hilarious. Mm-hmm. And then we were Deborah and Sarah. And then, our parents had the same names. And then I was the Gibson girl from the West End. So that was a cute story for that day. Yeah.
When we were talking about neighborhood people, mm-hmm. I think about Edgar Rich we call Edgar Rich the town crier. Good or bad, Edgar Rich gonna knock on the side of your house and tell you. We call Elsa Dean the Good Samaritan. Elsa Dean kept every child on the West End when their mama had to go to work. When the mama came home and the parents came home, Elsa Dean had cooked and cleaned and had the children clean and bathed and ready for bed. she went and took care of sick people in the neighborhood. Now, she didn't get paid for any of this. She went and took care of sick people in the neighborhood, and she was cooking biscuits. She could cook some biscuits, but my brother didn't like it because she had to make them up with her hands. And then she would pat them and thought they were dirty because she made them up with her hands. So she washed her hands, but she was a good lady. She was from a pastor's home in Greensboro, and she moved to Durham. And she said that she left her teaching. But she said, I left my teachings of Christ, but I didn't leave my habits behind because Daddy taught me well. And so she just had a good spirit. Cousin, no, that's the thing. She kept everything, and she kept even lives.
And she always kept a stick or a strap in her
hand. Sir, because she told you to do something, you better jump and do it.
That's right.
Well, I have to say,
our Taps chicken box, when Miss Lavinia and Mr. Claiborne opened up the store, he had a little glass showcase back there in the back where he sold some meats, and everybody cooked chicken on Sunday. So everybody would try to get the chicken from the chicken man or go down there and order from Mr. Tapp. Okay. Well, when Claiborne finished college, Claiborne helped his daddy out, helped his daddy and mama out in the store. And that basement down there that they were using for storage.
This was on Moorhead.
Yeah, on Moorhead. And he started selling fresh chickens. And he would give the chicken feet away. Well, people made chicken and dumplings out of the chicken feet. Now you have to buy the chicken feet now, but he gave the feet away. But he hired everybody. You see people walking with the plastic aprons on, because they work for Tap and the chicken. Eventually, Tap started making sandwiches, fried chicken sandwiches, and eventually, evolved into the restaurant. But he started down there when he came from college, wanted to be a businessman, and Daddy taught him, and he started down there with the chickens in the basement.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I can certainly say that I have enjoyed the conversation today and all the stories. They have been terrific. But we have one question that we would like to ask, and it's about the sports that were played at the Lion Park baseball field.
Tell
us about that.
Well, my mother played ball, and the children in the family laugh at me when I tell them, yeah, mother was a baseball player, boy, she could hit that ball and hit a home run every time she hit it. And so they had a girls team and they had a boys team. They played North Durham, they played East Durham, they played Walltown School, but they didn't have any place, to change their clothes. And the children, we sat on the hill, it was a little muddy hill. We sat on the hill up there, didn't even have any bleachers. And mother said, we ought to have some place for the spectators to sit when they come and watch the game. And so there was a little space at the top of the hill. She said, maybe they will put us a little recreation center up there and we can put some ping pong tables in there and some other things and let the children come and have a good time, have some place for them to go, but have little locker rooms for the sports people when they come so they have some place to change. So she talked to the lady across the street that was some kin to the parents. I can't remember her name right now, but she lived right in front of the store. And she said, yeah, Catherine, I will work with you on that. So mother went downtown. They said, well, if you can get 100 signatures saying that that's needed, we'll see about the, we'll present it to the city council and see if we can get y'all some kind of structure up there. And so mother got 100 names just real quick because everybody chipped in getting the names. But when they built the building, it wasn't what we thought it was going to be. We thought it was going to be larger than that and have activities in there so the kids would have some place to go other than be a Hogan, because Hogan's didn't really want the girls to come in there. That was Hogan's sports shop, and that was for the boys.
Okay.
But she wanted some place where all the kids could come and just have fun. But anyway, we got some kind of building up there. They never did put the bleachers up there unless they have them over there now, but they never did put any bleachers. But we wanted bleachers too.
Yeah, but it was good that Miss Catherine spoke up and some of the other things. And Miss Catherine Ruffin, she was a lovely lady. I loved her. I was a good friend of Carl and sister Cheryl. Cheryl and I were friends. And yeah, so Miss Catherine, she was very sweet. lady. Some of the things we were talking about in the community that we would like to see better changed is the housing situation in Durham now, because, you know, more affordable housing, because where, you know, when we lived there, like Judge Anderson said, it was a lot of like duplexes on Jackson Street where I live, because they made it like two family. But now people can't afford to even live in the houses that they used to live in. My uncle Willie and Aunt Gert, Willie Gibson and Aunt Gertrude Gibson, their house, they tore it down and made it two houses now. And the price of taxes is just phenomenal, you know, to live in the community on the West End. And all around Durham, of course.
Everywhere. Mm-hmm. And if they would make it, if when they say, we're going to buy this piece of land from you, and we're going to build some houses along here, they should make them affordable so the people can stay in the neighborhood. Some of them have lived there all their life. They don't want to move out, but they cannot afford to buy the house that they put there. Mm-hmm. And so then they have to look for other housing.
And you know, or pay the tax.
They built two big houses on that corner. But I think they're about $400,000 or $500,000. There's nobody along that could
afford a house.
So it's coming up on 1 o'clock. Time really flies. And I know there are some stories we didn't get to today because we talked about them in our rehearsal, which we should have recorded. And I see questions coming up in the chat that are things I came across when we were doing research too. So I'm sure there will be a part three of West End sometime soon. Thank you again to everyone who joined to watch today, but especially to our speakers. This time is just the best. So thank you all for sharing your stories with us and your photos and your memories. I want to also thank the staff who helped to make this happen and the city leadership and our department leadership for supporting this work. As always, you can see all of these recordings on the city's YouTube page. If you look for the city, there's still Our Community Stories as a whole like channel with all of these. They also show on the Durham Television Network Saturdays and Sundays at noon or around noon. So if you check that out, Saturdays and Sundays around noon. And this one will be available within the sometime early next week. And it will also, they're also on our Facebook page, Durham Community Engagement. Coming up next week, so excited to share with everyone the Harriet Tubman YWCA. One of our speakers will be Virginia Williams, who was part of the Royal Ice Cream, Royal 7, the Royal Ice Cream sit-in. And we'll have a few other people who are joining her, but that's going to be another really awesome event. So please help us spread the word, DurhamCommunityEngagement.org. And if you have any suggestions for speakers, you can contact me at Laura, my last name, Biediger, at the city. But if you check out our website, you'll find all of that information. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.